For better decision making, managers should become familiar with the concept of risk and the tools on how to measure risk. And of course, it's important for us to learn the basic concept of utility. At yan ang pag-aaralan natin sa ating lecture about risk analysis. The concept of risk and uncertainty. We focus on decisions involving risk, situations in which the consequences of any action the decision maker might take are uncertain because unforeseeable events may intervene that will affect his or her final situation. Decision making under certainty and uncertainty share three common features, whatever the setting. 1. The manager should be aware of all available actions. The manager must be aware of these uncertain events and how they will affect the outcome of any action he or she chooses. Moreover, after accounting for these uncertainties, the manager must assess or estimate the likelihood of alternative outcomes. 2. Determine the consequences of each action. In decisions under risk, the manager has a course of action that is missing in decisions under certainty. The option to acquire additional information about the risk before making the main decision. And 3, formulate a criterion for assessing each outcome. The manager must carefully assess the firm's attitude towards risk, that is, formulate a criterion that determines which risks are acceptable. The criterion can serve as a guide for choosing among risky alternatives. Uncertainty is present when there is more than one possible outcome for a decision. Roughly speaking, the greater the dispersion of possible outcomes, the higher the degree of uncertainty. The key to sound decision-making under uncertainty is to recognize the range of possible outcomes and assess the likelihood of their occurrence. Uncertainty is acknowledged in expressions such as, it is likely, the odds are, there is an outside chance, and so on. The difficulty with such qualitative expressions is that they are ambiguous and open to different interpretations. When prompted to ask, how likely is likely? The essential means for quantifying statements of likelihood is the use of probabilities. When a weather forecast from PAGASA states that there is a 75% chance of rain tomorrow in Metro Manila and Calabar Zone, this is far more useful than the claim that rain is likely. Accordingly, probability has been described as the mathematical language of uncertainty. In economics or financial theory, risk and uncertainty have somewhat different meanings, even though they are often used interchangeably. Although no future events are known with certainty, some events can be assigned with probabilities, and others cannot. Where future events can be defined and probabilities assigned, we have a case of risk. Thus, for instance, Happy Mushrooms sales manager estimates that next year's sales of shiitake mushroom have a 25% probability to be 30,000 kilograms, a 50% probability to be 35,000 kilograms, and a 25% probability to be 38,000 kilograms. If there is no way to assign any probabilities to future random events, we are addressing pure uncertainty. Sources of business risk. Uncertainty lies at the heart of many important decisions. Frequently, managers face an uncertain future and are uncertain about outcomes that have direct bearing on the firm's profit. The following are major sources of business risk. Number one, general economic situations. Firms face rising and declining paces of business cycle. They suggest that uncertainty concerning the future course of the macro economy, consumers and business spending, inflation, interest rate movements is an important factor for many industries and firms. Thus, a firm does not have the ability to completely prepare for these changes. Number two, information asymmetry of competitors' actions. Closely related to competitive actions are changes in technology. A firm's own technological breakthrough may bring about considerably increased sales. For instance, instant Facebook messaging application Messenger on the internet has disrupted the telephone businesses in the Philippines and other countries. Number three, impulses of consumers' demand. This creates another source of risk for the business person. Successful products of 1 year or one season may become the discarded, unwanted item. Sabi nila, popular ngayon, next time, di na uso. Number four, company costs and expenses. When estimates of future expenditures are made, the company cannot be sure what the prices of its factors of production will be. For example, unless they are entered into contract. Thus, the prices of materials can change, and so can the costs of electricity and other services. Labor costs and the cost of benefits are also subject to change unless union contracts are in existence. Probability concepts. The probability of an outcome is the odds or chance that the outcome will occur. In the usual parlance, we speak of probabilities as ranging between 0, it means deemed impossible, and 1, it means there is certainty. Basis for assessment. Number 1. We call it the objective notion. The notion of a probability as a long-run frequency. In an uncertain event, like a coin toss or a random draw, is repeated a very large number of times. The frequency of the event is a measure of its true probability. For instance, if a fair coin is tossed 1,000 times, the frequency of heads, such as the number of heads divided by the total number of tosses, will be very close to 0.50. If the actual long-run frequency turned out to be 0.60, we would be justified in assessing that the coin was unfair. Basis for assessment number 2, subjective notion. It should be evident that in many and perhaps most situations, there is no chance that a situation will be repeated, and therefore no way to assess probabilities on frequency grounds. In its development of a new product, one that is unique to the marketplace, Happy Mushrooms knows that the product launch is a one-shot situation. Happy Mushrooms believe that there is a 30% chance of success, but there is no way to validate this by launching the product 100 times and watching for 30 successes. Still another example is a business economist attempting to put ads on the likelihood of a new oil price shock, say a 50% rise in oil prices over the next 18 months. Decision makers rely on a subjective notion of probability. According to the subjective view, the probability of an outcome represents the decision maker's degree of belief that the outcome will occur. Of course, in making a probability assessment, the manager should attempt to analyze and interpret all pertinent evidence and information that might bear on the outcome in question. For the new product, this would include consumer surveys, test market results, the product's unique qualities, its price relative to prices of competing products, and so on. The point is that a subjective probability is not arbitrary or ad hoc. It simply represents the decision maker's best assessment based on current information of the likelihood of an uncertain event. Let's continue our discussion. Measurement of risk. In order for us to arrive at better decisions, managers should equip themselves to the various tools or techniques in measuring risk. First, risk measurement, probability distribution. A probability distribution describes in percentage terms the chances of all possible occurrences. When all the probabilities of the possible events are added up, they must total to 1. Because all possibilities together must equal to certainty. Thus, we may assign probabilities to various possible cash flows, as shown in Table 3.1. The 5 possible flows from Projects 1 and 2 occurs will depend, for instance, on general economic situations, the conditions of the industry, and the action of the competition. If all are favorable to the project, the cash flow will be 7,500 pesos and 8,500 pesos. If unfavorable conditions prevail, the cash flow will be only 3,500 and 2,500. Table 3.1 can also be translated into a bar chart, as shown in Figure 3.1. The second measure of risk is the expected value. The expected value associated with an uncertain situation is a weighted average of the payoff or values associated with all possible outcomes. The probabilities of each outcome are used as weights. Thus, the expected value measures the central tendency, the payoff or value that we would expect on average. More generally, if there are two possible outcomes having payoff X of 1 and X of 2, and if the probabilities of each outcome are given by P sub 1 and P sub 2, then the expected value is equal to P sub 1 times X sub 1 plus P sub 2 times X sub 2. When there are n possible outcomes, the expected value becomes P sub 1 times X sub 1 plus P sub 2 times X sub 2 plus up to P sub n times X sub n. Or, in summation form, we have the sum of the product of P sub I times X sub I, where I is equal to 1 to n, as in equation 3.1. As an illustration, we have illustration 3.1. Suppose that Filipino Tech Incorporated, a Laguna-based manufacturer of drones, believes that the probability is 0.60 that it can develop a new type of drone in 1 year, and the probability is 0.40 that it cannot do so in this length of time. If Filipino Tech Incorporated will earn a profit of 10 million pesos if it develops the new drone in 1 year, and loss 7 million pesos if it does not develop the drone in 1 year, we can readily calculate the expected value of the profit, which is equal to 3.2 million pesos. Illustration 3.2. An offshore oil exploration by Benham Rice Limited has two possible outcomes. Success yields a payoff of 700 pesos per share. Failure, a payoff of 200 pesos per share. We express the expected value in this case as follows, or the computed expected value is equal to 325 pesos per share. Illustration 3.3. Suppose that Jose Corporation, a producer of automobile tires, is thinking of raising the price of its product by 1,000 pesos per tire. Based on estimates, if it raises its price, it will experience an 800,000 pesos profit if advertising campaign is successful, and will lose 500,000 pesos if the campaign is not successful. The managers believe that there is a 0.50 probability that this advertising campaign will be successful, and 0.50 probability that it will not be successful. Under these circumstances, the expected value of profit if Jose Corporation raises its price will be equal to 150,000 pesos. What would be the expected value of profit if the firm did not increase its price? Suppose that the managers believed that if there were no price increase, the firm's profit with certainty would be 250,000 pesos. Thus, if Jose Corporation wants to maximize the expected value of its profit, it should not increase its price. Illustration 3.4. Using equation 3.1, the expected annual net cash flows for peso equity mutual funds A and B are calculated as follows, as in the following table. For peso equity mutual fund A, the expected value is 300 pesos, and for mutual fund B equals to 300 pesos. In this example, both peso equity mutual fund A and B have expected values of annual net cash flows equaling to 300 pesos. In economics and finance, risk is considered to be the dispersion of possible outcomes around the expected value. The greater the potential differences from the average, the greater is the risk. Thus, to measure risk, we must find some yardstick that reflects the variation of possible outcomes from this average. A concept prominent in elementary statistics is used for this purpose is the standard deviation. The standard deviation is the square root of the weighted average of the squared deviations of all possible outcomes from the expected value. And the formula is given in equation 3.2. Illustration 3.5. The calculation of the standard deviations for peso equity mutual funds A and B is shown in the following table. So, for peso equity mutual fund A, the standard deviation is equal to 63.24 pesos. As for peso equity mutual fund B, the standard deviation is calculated at 126.49 pesos. These calculations show that peso equity mutual fund B appears to be riskier than peso equity mutual fund A because the expected cash flows from peso equity mutual fund B are more variable. Problems sometimes arise when standard deviation is used to measure risk. If an investment project is relatively expensive and has large expected cash flows, it will have a large standard deviation of returns without being truly riskier than a smaller project. Consider illustration 3.6. Suppose project A has an expected return of 1 million pesos and a standard deviation of only 1,000 pesos. Some will argue that it is less risky than an alternative project B with expected return of 1,000 pesos and a standard deviation of 900 pesos. The absolute risk of project A is greater. The risk of project B is much larger than the expected payoff. Finally, the fourth measure of risk is the coefficient of variation. Relative risk is the variation in possible returns compared with the expected payoff amount. A popular method for determining relative risk is to calculate the coefficient of variation. It is defined as the ratio of the standard deviation to the expected value, as in equation 3.3. In general, when comparing decision alternatives with costs and benefits that are not of approximately equal size, the coefficient of variation measures relative risk better than does the standard deviation. Consider illustration 3.7, project A and project B. So, calculating the coefficient of variations for these two projects, we have for project A equals to 0.001 and for project B, which is equal to 0.19. Returns on project B have a larger coefficient of variation, which is 0.90, than do returns of project A, which is equal to 0.001. Therefore, even though the standard deviation is smaller, project B is the more risky of the two projects. Another illustration. Let's consider illustration 3.8. When the expected values of listed companies ABC and XYZ are equal or at least close to one another, the standard deviation is a proper measure of risk. But since the standard deviation is an absolute measure, it may not serve our purposes if listed companies ABC and XYZ are compared having differing expected values, as presented in the following table. The coefficient of variation is greater for listed company XYZ. Thus, despite the fact that listed company ABC's standard deviation is higher in absolute terms, its relative risk is lower, since ABC's expected value is greater and relative risk is smaller, listed company ABC is preferable. Attitude towards risk. Three possible attitudes towards risk are present. So we have risk aversion, risk neutrality, and risk seeking. What about risk aversion? Risk aversion characterizes decision makers who seek to avoid or minimize risk. As for risk neutrality, it characterizes decision makers who focus on expected returns and disregard the dispersion of returns. And for risk seeking, ito yung mga tinatawag natin risk lovers, characterizes decision makers who prefer risk. In practice, entrepreneurs, innovators, inventors, speculators, and lotto ticket buyers display risk-seeking behaviors. They prefer high-risk investments with substantial returns, especially when relatively small sums of peso are involved. Risk-neutral behavior is exhibited in some business decision-making. However, most managers and investors are predominantly risk averters, especially when substantial peso amounts are involved. The final concept in relation to the study of risk analysis is the concept of utility, or the level of satisfaction that we derive from consuming a particular product or services. That is the central to risk aversion is the notion of diminishing marginal utility of money. If someone with no money receives 1,000 pesos, it can satisfy his or her most immediate needs. So, ibig sabihin, mataas yung level ng satisfaction. If such a person then receives a second 1,000 pesos, it will obviously be useful. But the second 1,000 pesos is not quite so necessary as the first 1,000 pesos. Ibig sabihin, yung utility na nareceive niya from the second 1,000 pesos ay mas mababa compared sa unang 1,000 pesos. Thus, the utility of the second 1,000 pesos is less than the utility of the first 1,000 pesos and so on. Diminishing marginal utility of money implies that marginal utility of money diminishes for additional increments of money. To summarize, there are at least 5 points to remember. Number 1, decision making under certainty and uncertainty share 3 common features. Number 2, there are major sources of risk. Number 3, probability has been described as the mathematical language of uncertainty. Number 4, there are ways to measure or quantify risk. And number 5, of course, we should not forget the 3 possible attitudes towards risk. Thank you very much for listening to this lecture, and hope to see you again to our upcoming lectures. Bye-bye!